You're listening to the Vibrant Happy Women Podcast, episode number 110.
Welcome to the Vibrant Happy Women Podcast, stories of vibrant women living happy lives. And now your host, Jen Riday.
Hey there, welcome to Vibrant Happy Women. I'm Dr. Jen Riday, your host. And this is the place to be if you want to shift from burned out to finding yourself, taking care of yourself, healing your heart, healing your relationships, and figuring out your purpose so you can live it and feel happy from the inside out. Welcome to the show. Our review of the week comes from Kerwill, and she says, I adore this podcast and get a happy boost every time I see that there's a new episode in my feed to listen to. What a wonderful gift to all of us. Thank you, Jen, for the inspiration and uplift. So much goodness here. Well, thank you for leaving a review. That means the world. And we read every single review. And if any of you listening would like to leave a review, it helps so much. You can do so at jenriday.com/iTunes. Today, I'll be talking with Anne Adametz, an amazing friend and woman who is also a fellow Wisconsinite, who speaks so clearly and in such an enlightening, uplifting way about finding peace in the midst of chaos. There is so much to learn from Anne, and we're going to go ahead and dive right in now. My guest today is Anne Adametz, and she's a mentor, combining her years as an acupuncturist, yoga therapist, business owner, and mom into distilled sessions, helping people transform their mindset, feel strong, feel peaceful in any situation. Sign me up, Anne. How does she know? Well, within 5 years, Anne lost both her brother and her mother, leaving her family emotionally traumatized and spiritually confused. Anne sought out world experts, and through the study of what was happening to her internally and out, she earned the tools to successfully help others heal mind and body, then transform their life experience into riches to share it with others. Anne distills these timeless world-class tools to help people heal and live dreams, and this co-creation is a multiplication that can change the world one beautiful person at a time. Anne lives in Stoughton, Wisconsin with her husband and her son. Welcome to the show, Anne, my neighbor.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. I love being here. I'm a huge fan of the show, and I'm so excited that you're co-creating with all of these amazing people. I'm just totally stoked to be here.
Yeah, I'm so glad to have you. And why don't you say Stoughton for us? And we want to hear your Norwegian accent because it's Wisconsin.
You got to say it. Yes. Like I said, they'll know that you're a fake if you're not Norwegian and in Stoughton. So you have to say Stoughton.
I love it. So I have a neighbor across the street that's Norwegian, and it's the funniest thing. But a lot of times when he gets to talking fast, he'll say dat instead of that. And he's been in the U.S., I mean, for generations, but that accent came down the line and it's still here. I love it.
Oh, I love it. I love it too. I love the Wisconsin accent. And it took me a lot of years to realize that we all say Wisconsin and not Wisconsin is how everyone else says it. So yes, there's a lot of that.
Well, let's start off with one of your favorite quotes and then we'll jump into your story.
Okay. So my favorite quote, there's so many, so hard to choose. But the number one, because it is how that guides my life, is that peace is the goal, the way, and the means to get there.
Oh, the goal, the way, and the means. Oh, yeah. So how have you applied that one in your life?
Well, I would say with every single day, every person, every minute. And that's what I love about the practice is that it seems like there's so much going on and there's so many issues. And I just know that I'm rooted in that. And I'm rooted in the fact that it's got to come down to that, that that's my legacy, that that's the way that I want to live. That's my goal as a human being is to feel peace. And so, like, for example, if you think about all of the different goals, the short-term goals, and I work with a coach and I am a coach, and it's like all these goals that we have, these short-term goals, it's like, oh, if I get that thing and then I'll feel better and then I'll be peaceful. If I accomplish this or if I get this done or if I, you know, my family's all well and good, then I'll feel peaceful. Mm-hmm. And it's like that keeps being what I think these short-term goals are, what I keep thinking are the goal. But behind all those goals is that I just want to feel peaceful. Mm-hmm. And all my training and everything I've done up to this point has led me to realize that you can skip the thing you think is going to bring you the goal and just focus on the goal itself and be that peace. So for me, whenever I go through troubles or issues, I think, how to get back to peace? How can I be peaceful? And that's my guiding light and my grounding rod.
Isn't that so true? We're all probably chasing peace, or at least a little bit of fun and happiness, but
right.
We try and try and try and try. And really, we could just sit in a chair and probably accomplish it so much faster and easier if we knew how. So if someone's totally in that place of chaos or sadness or something has happened, what do you recommend they do to return to peace in that easier way instead of chasing it?
Well, I think, you know, the very first thing is to decide what the goal is, because a lot, just yesterday I sat with a young woman and she's going through a really tough time. She's got a child that has to go in for a serious surgery and there's a substantial risk there. And so the stress is so high and it's almost unmanageable. Mm-hmm. And so what happens a lot of times, like anybody, you know, you would sit and you'd ruminate on all the worst case scenario and you start to worry and freak out and be really, you know, really worried about the whole situation, put a lot of negative energy around it. So what I do when I hear these stories is to try to hear them with, you know, with what Ram Dass calls unimaginable or unbearable compassion, because it's a lot to take on. It's a lot to deal with. And then what I know from my training is that everything is temporary. You know, one of the basic concepts of yoga and life and all of this is that every single thing is temporary. So I remember that. And then I remember the goal is like the only thing I have control over in this whole situation is me and what do in this situation. And so I don't have control, and she doesn't have control over the outcome of that surgery. I don't have control of how she feels about it. All I know is that what we have right now in this moment is the power that I have. Even if I want to change the past or affect the future, I can only do that right now in this moment. And it can only be me that does it. And I can't control what happens, but I can control how I deal with it. And so that's what I come back to, that grounding in, like, I can only control me. And then that, what's my goal? Peace. So how to get there? How to get there? And if everything is temporary and everything is shifting, then me grasping on to trying to make it something, is that gripping is what's causing a lot of the friction and the tension.
Yes. That reminds me of things I've said on this podcast before, but the expectation of a certain outcome is what causes all the stress and friction. Of course. Yeah.
That's right.
Good reminder.
That's right.
Huh. So do we just let go of our desired outcome and just accept what is?
Well, there you go. You just mined all of yoga down to one thing, which is let go.
Let go.
Nice job, by the way. Nice work.
Oh, thank you.
That's true. That's exactly what it is. My teachers, I had the extreme privilege to study with world masters, the Mohan family of Swasti Yoga. And, you know, they came from India. They took care of Krishnamacharya. A lot of the yoga today that's taught in the West is from Krishnamacharya, who is one of the last living yogis of the lineages, like a lot of people came from that lineage, and they took care of him for the last 18 years of his life. And I was really privileged to study with them. I did a lot of teacher training with them. And then I did yoga therapy training with them. And they literally wrote the book Yoga Therapy. And so luckily enough, I got a chance to learn so much from them. And what they used to say, Mohanji used to say, is that if you mine all of yoga down and all of this meditation and all of it down to one thing, to one process, it's let go.
Wow. Wow. So,
which is easier said than done.
Yeah. What do you think? I mean, I'm thinking of all the things we have built into our society that almost make it more difficult to let go, like social expectations of how you're supposed to be in a marriage or how you're supposed to raise your kids or what you should do to be a good, quote unquote, Christian or religions, you know, all of it. How do you let go of that and still function within society? I mean, that's maybe an impossible question to answer, but we can try.
Well, I think that's absolutely necessary right now in this moment in time, because so many people are trying to lead an authentic lifestyle. They're trying to be who they are, and they're trying to do that, but yet be a good person with all of our faults and all of our emotions and all of that. And that's why I love yoga as a system, because it says that you really only can control yourself. You really only are responsible for your own karma. And I talk about that in my yoga classes. I'm like, here's the good news, is that you really only have one person to control, and that's you. That's the great news, okay? Because even if you think you control your kids, even if you think you control your husband or what, all these relationships, even if you think you can Machiavelli and like put strings on them and like make them do what you want to do by saying the right thing or doing the right thing, you really can't. And all of that buildup and all of that, you know, all of that, I call it like putting out a little puppet and showing that to the world. All of that is what separates us. And I feel like what brings us together is that vulnerability, is that humanness. and rooted in peacefulness and kindness. That's the goal, the way, the means. That's how we can function together, is be peaceful and loving towards one another, but be totally honest in terms of being who you are and walking this path.
Well, that's beautiful. I love vulnerability and humanness. And then you mentioned unbearable compassion. That's awesome. Well, let's hear more about your story, how you got to this place of, you know, understanding and wisdom that so many need in this world. And that's why I'm sure you're such an amazing coach to so many here in the Wisconsin area and probably beyond. But how did you get to that place? What learning has happened for you over the years?
Oh, gosh. You know, I think, you know, like with a lot of people, that I've got an up and down tail. And that's one thing I love about my job, is that I get to hear how people are where they are. But I started out, you know, growing up in a farm life and had a big family. There's 7 of us, 5 kids, and it was a hard scrabble situation. There wasn't a lot of money. I remember that we shared the farm with my grandfather and my uncle, and we were the ones with 7 people, and our share of the earnings for 1 month didn't cover the light bill, I remember. So we had really specific economic challenges and that. But within all that, I had a really awesome family. Like, my mom was a really strong personality. My dad's an incredible person, and just my sisters and family, and just really great people. So we had a hard scrabble growing up, but it was a lot of love and a lot of hard work.
Ah, nice.
Yeah. So that's really what I'm grounded in, is, you know, even though it was a lot of suffering, a lot of stress, it was a lot of really strong connection there for me. So I was really lucky about that. And so, you know, I was one of the first people, my sister and I were the first to go to university, and we graduated, and that was really awesome. And I did a really great job there. And then I really fell in love with traveling and ended up traveling quite a bit. And even though we did have a lot of money, someone told me in college, hey, why don't you just use your financial aid to try to just put that towards study abroad?
Yeah.
And so I totally did it. And that was the best decision I ever made.
Smart.
Because, girl, I ain't missing that money right now at
right.
all.
Right.
So, yeah. So I tell everyone to do that. So when I did that, I fell in love with traveling, and I fell in love with all of these perspectives of life. And I loved all of it. Not everybody loves people. I love people. And I just couldn't get over how amazing that was. But then when I came back, it was kind of a hard reality to come back to, you know, daily grind and life and finishing school and things like that. And then I had a really great opportunity. I had a full ride scholarship to a graduate school.
Wow.
And that was, yeah, right. And I was like, wow, this is the greatest thing in the world. I'm so awesome. I'm doing great. And then I went to the school and I realized I was an English major, and it was like more of an old English studying thing. And I really didn't like it. And I really couldn't get my head wrapped around it. I really couldn't understand it. And I literally was going to flunk out or drop out. And so I had a full ride scholarship and a stipend and everything. And I thought, oh my gosh, what did I con my way into this? Like, I had so many questions about, you know, I'm really a loser right now. This is a total hot mess. And I remember I went to the counselor, school counselor, and I was bawling, and I couldn't even talk. She goes, why don't you come back tomorrow? Literally, because I was crying so hard.
Oh, no.
So then I came back and I was like, oh, I can't. I just couldn't. I don't think I could even. I don't even know how to fix stuff. I can't even be like a janitor here. I can't do anything. I'm terrible. And she's like, well, you know, you can probably make it through this, and you could probably just do something different. And I just thought, I can't. I'm a total failure. So I ended up dropping out of a full scholarship, a full ride. I was a TA there. I dropped out of everything, and I moved back home with my parents after traveling the world and all of this.
Oh, yeah. A recipe for major depression, right?
Gosh, I can't even tell you. Humble pie. And I'm a really strong, independent person. So leaving home was big. And so I moved back, and my brother and sister, 2 of my siblings, were still living at home. And my dad got me a job as a landscaper, because I was that depressed. He got me a job as a landscaper with my brother, who is, you know, 7 years younger than me. And I spent the summer with my brother, which was pretty kind of cool, because I didn't really know my brother as well at this point as of him being a young adult. He was 18. And so we spent the summer landscaping together in this beautiful place, this private estate. And it was a gorgeous drive. We had a brilliant summer. I got to know him really well. We became actually really good friends. And then when that was over, I figured it was time to grow up and go back into corporate America. So I came, entered into that. I went to got into Madison, and I got some really great jobs and some great opportunities, and rose to middle management pretty quickly, and made a great deal of money, had a car, had a gas card, all that great stuff. And even with all that, though, the stress of being corporate America and the ups and downs of that started to get to me. And I started feeling like, really stressed out, like the workload and the time management. And even though I was single and you'd think you had everything, it was pretty stressful. And, you know, you can only drink so much. You can only do Thirsty Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, fun day. And, you know, only that lasts only so long and you got to get up on Monday.
Right.
So I was going through some pretty stressful times and I got into yoga and someone had told me about it and I had experienced some pretty strong relief from it in college, but wasn't really serious about it. And then I started to get some relief, but that's when my brother was in a car accident. So this is this, you know, the fall of the year that I was with him and he got into a car accident and unfortunately he ended up passing away from that car accident.
Whoa.
And that's when I was like, okay, this stress is unmanageable. And the pain and the loss and all of that was just like, I was really reeling at that point from stress. And that's when I just went headlong into yoga and said, I've got to find a way to deal with this. And I've got to find a way to let go, essentially, especially of that situation and learn how to cope. And that's when I started doing yoga, you know, a lot. And once I started doing yoga a lot and getting some relief and getting just a few moments peace, then I was like, well, there's got to be more than just the physical part of this. There's something going on here. And that's when I ended up leaving corporate America and moving to Chicago with my now husband. And that's when I started studying yoga and started, you know, I got a part-time job. I started studying yoga. And that's when I just kept on moving through that and learning with all these great masters, had a lot of great breaks. And right in the middle of some teacher training and meeting the Mohans is when my mom unexpectedly passed away from a pulmonary embolism.
Wow.
So it was like this. But at that time, to be honest with you, I was right where I needed to be. I was right learning all of these lessons. I was studying yoga full time. I was doing my dream job at that time. And I was starting to enter into Chinese medicine and acupuncture. So all of these things, I had just like this full-time study of what this was all about and how to do it. So that's really how I came to learn a lot of what I've learned. And then just these life situations where I just had to apply it and really bring it back home to my family who is struggling with all of this and bring home this wisdom and help all of us cope really.
Well, so what did that look like? You know, farm family. And then, you know, are you the oldest or the second oldest?
Second.
Second oldest. Okay. The second oldest daughter heads to the big city and learns all this Eastern stuff. And then you bring it back. How receptive were they? And what did that look like?
Well, let me tell you, I have a really, really interesting family. And I think that farm life, my dad was kind of the vet. You know, you didn't always call the vet. There was somebody around that knew quite a lot about that, birth, the animals and things like that. And my dad was kind of that guy in our community. He was kind of Charles Ingalls is what I call him.
Like, that's
mom,
cool.
Yeah. And my mom was like the Carolyn, right? Because she was like the person who a lot of people came to for advice. So
really?
They were already pretty tied to really excited about learning more about this kind of stuff. And they used a lot of home remedies and they used a lot of old timey, you know, things like that. So they were pretty stoked.
Wow.
And right before my mom, she came down and saw me and she was like, gosh, I just can't wait for you to get all this information because I've got carpal tunnel. And you know, they were excited. They were like, come
that's so
and
great.
Help us out.
Yeah.
Yes. You know, and I learned a lot from my parents. My dad actually is the first person who taught me. We actually left the farm when I was about in seventh grade because they had a falling out with a family and my dad wanted to buy the farm and they didn't want to split it up like that. And my dad took off and became a horse person, which was his dream. And with five kids, he did that. And he actually became a world champion horse logger. And he was the farrier at the Midwest Horse Fair and a speaker there. And he really is quite a person to follow in his footsteps as well.
Oh, you do have amazing parents. Wow. That's great. Well, so going back to that pain of your mom dying, and I'm just trying to imagine that level of pain. And I know many of our listeners out there are struggling. Well, okay. All of our listeners out there are struggling with
yes.
something right now that hurts and is frustrating and exhausting. What do you do with deep, deep, deep emotional pain like that? How do you work through it so you can let it go like you talked about?
Well, I'm really glad you talk about the emotion piece of it because I am a really emotional person. Mm-hmm. And my big question when I went into all this study was like, well, what do I do with my emotions? Because I just want to like, and that's where I got into a lot of problems too. Like, oh, I'm just so angry about everything. And then I just would act from that space of anger and create more problems for myself. or I would be so sad. And I actually did some extensive grief counseling, and that was a big turning point for me, because when all of the emotions, and that's what I love about Chinese medicine, is that they incorporate that as part of your health, is emotional health is part of your health.
And
it's important, right? We have an emotion, and in the Chinese believe that, you know, every season has a different emotion. We're in spring right now. It's a time of anger. So if you're been agitated lately, it's timely. It's a good time for treatment.
Okay. That makes sense.
So, and it stirs up a lot of stuff in the spring, but the emotional piece of it's really important. And, you know, someone was saying, there was a study done and about how long emotion should last. And we need every single emotion, right? They're all important. We vilify certain emotions, right? Like, oh, you shouldn't have anger, or you shouldn't be mad, or you shouldn't have sadness. But all of them are really integral, and they just become either in balance or out of balance. So, for example, the Chinese will say that if you have an emotion in balance, it should rise up. There's an amount of time that you want to work with it, listen to it, honor it, and then it passes. And if you spend too much time with it, you overdo the emotion, like I'm always angry, that becomes an illness, right? That becomes an illness. Or if you push it down and don't deal with it, then that comes out as an illness. Like you never talk about it or anything like that. And then it just becomes stress and tension inside. So they say that there's an acceptable amount of time to honor it. So for example, like with anger, it's something's important here. So like, why would, like, if you think about anger in a, like a guttural sense, why would we need anger? What's the purpose of anger?
Mm-hmm. Are you asking me? Okay. I would say yes. Anger is a mask for something below it, which is fear or, yeah, fear probably.
Okay, so this is really good that it's like a mask. It's like covering up something. So like, if you think about like a mother bear or something that would get angry, like what are they doing? Why are they get angry?
Yeah, afraid their cubs will get hurt, right? Yeah.
Right, exactly. So it's a protection mechanism, right? So, and it's really important one. It's a very important mechanism to say, hey, something is not right here. This cannot continue. So here's where my yoga training comes in large, because I used to just say, this isn't right, and then go off in that same anger energy and overdo it. Like the Chinese say, like, that's going to cause me a problem because I'm going to act from the emotion and not let it inform me of what the issue is.
Mm.
So when I sit with anger and say, what's making me angry? Okay, what am I protecting? And then what I say is, it's almost always, you know, it comes down to yourself. You're protecting yourself or your family. And so when I come down, then I come back to that peace is the way, the goal, the means. And that's where it becomes a choice on what I decide to do with this breach of my protection, how I decide to fortify my life, how I decide to sort of fortify my family, how I decide with boundaries, with, you know, deciding in actions, what actions I'm going to take, all of those sorts of things. Does that make sense?
Yeah. It's almost like anger saying, wake up, something needs to happen here. And we, if we get lost and don't go to that deeper level, we don't solve anything. I love that. So you're like, taking it deeper, what can I fix? What can I fortify? What action should I take? And just recognizing it's self-preservation. Ooh, that's good, Anne. That's really good.
And I love it because I actually, there's a talk that I do because it's called The Purpose of Emotions. And it talks about why we have each emotion. Like so many people don't want to ever have anxiety, but anxiety is awesome.
Oh.
You need anxiety. Every single person is going to experience anxiety. Everybody on this phone called and probably freaked out when I said anxiety is awesome.
Yeah. I want to know what you're talking about. Yeah.
Because it seems like anxiety sucks. I do not want that. It's the worst. I want to stop it from happening. But that's that pushing down of it and stopping it. And, you know, you use the word, you said that, you know, it's like something that I've got to pay attention to. And I use the word alarm. Because all of these are saying, whoa, 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 something needs to happen. Then once I understand the mechanism for the emotion, then I can understand why I'm having it. So like, when would you experience anxiety?
Usually for me, it's when somebody is in danger or there's something really unknown. I guess anxiety is when you're unknown or unsure about the future, I suppose.
That's exactly right. Okay, because you're unknown about the future. But let me give you a little like behind the scenes spoiler alert is that all future is uncertain.
Right. Spoiler alert.
I'm sorry to be the one to break it to you. That everything is temporary and we don't know what's going to happen. Even if you, this is that expectation bit where if I think that, oh, it's got to be this way and I want it to be this way and I get really attached to that and everything is temporary, here's where the let go piece comes is like I can put forward, I'm only in control of me. I can put forward my best effort. I can do everything I want to do, but I cannot control how this turns out. And at the end of the day, that's what I can let go of is everything outside of my intention and my goal. And that's why I love to be rooted in peace is the way, the goal, the means, because I know that I'm grounded the way that I need to be. And that's all I can control.
Yeah.
And like with the anxiety piece, you're talking about future things. And we feel anxiety when we've got like all these mental windows open on all these things that, okay, maybe they all need to get done, but they don't all need to get done right now. And so I'm like creating this huge scenario where I'm putting extreme pressure on myself or worrying about something that's not even happening. And then I create for myself a pressure cooker and an alarm goes off that says, hey, whoa, what's happening right now? You can't control all that stuff. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then once you go, so one of the tools I use is to say like, is this happening? Or what was I just thinking about? So what was I just thinking about? And I'll say, oh, I was just listing all my to-dos. Well, then I can just dump all my to-dos into a list and then start again. And then, oh, what was I just thinking about? Well, I'm worried about a lot of things. Or I'm worried about what if this happens? And then I'll just say to myself, is it happening right now? And if it's not happening right now, then I'm manufacturing a negative outcome.
Oh, boy.
And so is it happening right now has really helped me. Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
Is it happening? And that's that power of now or that being in the present moment. That's why it's so important because you only have this. You don't have the future to fix right now. You just have this moment.
Mm-hmm. So I talk a lot about self-love on the show, and I feel like a place that was important for me to become grounded, where I didn't need to worry as much or be stuck in these emotions, really self-love was a foundation of that. Somehow developed the idea that I was worthy and that I had everything inside of me to take care of myself. Do you have any tips on getting to that place or what you've seen that look like for your clients or for yourself?
Well, you know, my son just had this mindfulness expert come to school, and he came into the school and he spoke to the kids and the kids loved him, and he did it through hip hop. And his name is Just, oh my gosh, this guy is cool. You have to check him out. His name is Just Me, J-U-S-T-M-E. And he does these mindfulness raps, and my son was way into it, like big time into it. And a lot of the kids loved it. And he did this special opportunity, which I wish was something that every parent could have made it to, but it was at 3:00. And So I went, he got up in front of the teachers and stood on a chair. Uh-huh. And he goes, I know I'm not supposed to be standing on a chair here. And he's like, but I want to talk to y'all about mindfulness. I want you to hear me. And they're like, okay. And he's this really cool guy. He said, you know, I just want to tell you right now that I've been working on this for the last 5 years. And the last year is the first year that I really love myself.
Oh.
It's the first time I can say I love myself. And he said that in front of all of these teachers and of people he didn't know. And I started tearing up immediately because I know that feeling where you get on the opposite side of yourself, or you don't stick up for yourself, or you don't even really know yourself because you're trying so hard to help everybody around you so then you can feel peace. And what's really helped me is realizing that I'm really trying to make everything around me peaceful, so then I'll feel peace, or I can just go straight to the source and focus on it for myself.
Oh, yeah. I love it. Say that part again. So I can focus on everyone around me. How did that go?
It's like when you come home and clean your house.
Yeah.
So that, okay, if everything's perfect around me, then I'll be relaxed and I can relax. But it's like, you don't have to do all of that. You just come home to yourself and say that this is the way, the goal, the means. Like, me feeling peaceful is the most important thing. And I can get it for myself. And if I'm peaceful, then I create that environment around me that everyone can then feel peaceful or not. But that's not my job. If you feel peaceful, it's not my job. My job is if I feel peaceful.
Yeah.
And taking care of my person.
And for you, that peace comes easiest through yoga, or there are other components that are part of that for you now?
You know, there's so many components. And, you know, part of it, too, is a reflection of the people that I surround myself with, too, is that once that, you know, I'm lucky enough to have grown up with a family who is really loving. And so I know what that's worth. And not to just to be loving, but the real root key is to be unconditionally loving.
Ooh.
So that means it doesn't mean like if you deserve it, or you did a lot of stuff and now you deserve my time and energy or that sort of thing. It just means that no matter what, you're worthy of love. And that is a really, that's like the greatest gift you can give yourself or anyone else. And so my biggest aspect of getting to peace is really the absence of judgment. It's like, it doesn't have to be great or it doesn't have to be bad. It just is. And that place is not like something has to happen to sustain it. You can just be okay with the current situation. You use the word acceptance, which I think is really a big piece of it, is it doesn't mean that you love it, that you're glad that it happened. It's just that you accept that this is the current state of the way that things are, and it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when it comes to being self-love, it's accepting all sides of yourself. And when he said that in that talk, it reminded me of the time when I really came to love myself, no matter what, because I really realized that I learn better through failure than I do from wins.
Oh.
Unfortunately, I'm that kid. I was that kid. My parents would love to tell you that I was that kid that made the mistakes, that got into trouble, that, like, you know, always had to push the boundaries, that disagreed, mm-hmm. that was a strong personality. But what do we need right now but strong personalities and strong people? So I think, you know, loving myself, and when I teach others how to get there, it's like, why not love it all? Like, you can't just love, oh, I like it when I do a really good thing, or I'm really proud of it, or someone tells me that they're proud of me. That's really great. And I like to surround myself with people who do love me unconditionally, but I'm not always going to get that. So it's up to me to love those other sides that aren't so great. And that's where the real work comes in, is to really accept the really dark parts of ourselves.
Wow. Why not love it all?
As much. Love it all.
Ooh, yeah. Well, if we achieve it, we have become, you know, peace masters, right?
That is exactly right. That is right. Let it go.
Listen, if you need new window treatments, whether you want blinds, shades, drapes, or shutters, you need to contact Smith & Noble. Smith & Noble has covered over 8 million windows nationwide. They are the custom window treatment experts. They will transform your windows within your budget and without any hassle. The entire team at Smith & Noble is committed to quality and making sure that you have the best experience start to finish. Have fun creating a look you'll love from their extensive collection of handcrafted blinds, shades, drapes, and shutters. If you need advice, they have free design consultation in your home or by phone, and then let Smith & Noble take care of the rest. Their experts will measure for free, no worry about making mistakes. Plus, they offer professional installation for a guaranteed perfect fit, or they'll make it right at no cost to you. Smith & Noble is the best choice for updating your window treatments. And great news, they are giving my listeners, you, the Vibrant Happy Women listeners, this fantastic limited time offer to get you started. 25% off your Smith & Noble window treatments. But to get this deal, you must go to my special URL. For details on this great offer, go to smithandnoble.com/happywomen. Again, that's smithandnoble.com/happywomen. And I'm totally loving this. And I just want to give you the chance to take the conversation where you think it needs to go. So you talked about unconditional love and peace is the absence of judgment. What else is important for creating that inner peace in the middle of chaos?
Well, I think that something that's difficult for us to wrap our heads around is that it's a practice, because I think we think that, you know, if I just get to somewhere, then I'm going to be peaceful. Like, I did a 10-day meditation retreat. I've done it twice now, where you go for 10 days, you don't read, you don't write, you don't talk, you don't make eye contact, and you meditate for 10 hours a day for 10 days.
Wow.
And like an intense experience. It's called Vipassana, and it's a fantastic experience. It's a horrible, amazing, you know, mind-bending experience. But I think, like, we set ourselves up to say, like, when I went to that, I'm like, okay, when I get done with that, then I'm going to be peaceful. Then I'm all done.
Right.
Or when I get this thing done, then I'm going to feel peaceful. Or when I, you know, when my kids grow up and get out of the house, finally, thank God, then I'll be peaceful. Or I never want this to end. I want it to always be like this. And then I would be peaceful if it was always like this. And so it's like we set up a lot of conditions around ourselves, but it's really the practice. And I think practicing peace all the time is where it's at, because it's practicing it not just when it's easy to practice peace, or practicing self-love when it's easy to love yourself. It's practicing it all the time, especially when it's hard,
mm-hmm.
and practicing that period of it. So the practice for me begins right in the morning when I wake up. I used to get up and start getting up and start doing my to-do list in my head, or I started to say, like, oh, I started the anxiety thing, right? Like, where you scare yourself with every single thing you have to do in the next 6 weeks. Oh my gosh. And you just don't even want to get out of bed. I used to do that. I was really into that for a while. But then I started thinking, like, okay, wait a second, this isn't really working for me. And I had listened to this podcast. They talked about when you get up the first thing of the day. And I know this is something also that I've learned, you know, from a lot of times, but just didn't really put it into practice. But that first thought of the day is like setting your navigation. It's like if you get in a car and just start driving and you have no place to go, who knows where you're going to end up? You're going to be at the mercy of wherever the road takes you. But if you get up and set that navigation, like for me, I know my goal is peace, right? It's the way, it's the goal and the means. And I say to myself when I wake up that first thing in the morning is, okay, I'm going to breathe in peace. And I'm going to breathe out whatever else is there. And I'm going to let whatever else be there. I'm going to look at it when it goes. I'm just going to be noticing what was there in the first place, what was already coming up. And I just take that moment to practice that this is my alignment. And I call it like align and shine or whatever you want to call it. But I take that moment. And of course, my mind wants to go to my to-do list or all these things I've got to do. But instead, I keep calling it back and just train the mind to say, okay, peace is what I'm wanting to feel all the time. So it's the way, the goal, the means. So I'm just going to breathe it in and wait until I fill up with it. And that's what I did before I got on this call. It's just like, okay, no matter what happens, it's just, this is what I'm here to do. This is my job. And so that practice. And then when I used to be like list and worry, I would get up with that energy. And then I would go wake my son up. And I'd be like, come on, John, come on, let's go. And I'd like push him to the bus. And it was just this frenetic, really agitated morning because I was in a vibration of worry and anxiety and all of that. And I was just littering it around my house. Like I was the environment of that.
Wow.
And so when I changed that and there was some transition period. So it's a practice, right? It's not a perfect right off the bat. There was a transition period, but I committed to doing that every morning. And then I just thought, all I have to do is thought, word, and action is peace. And if I don't know what to say, it's time for me to be quiet and just leave and go downstairs and make breakfast. Like if John, you know, if my son didn't really want to do that morning, then I would just be quiet and walk away and just take my energy and myself and move it. And over just a really short period of time, he started just coming right along and getting up and coming down. And the other thing I would do is go in the morning and say peaceful and kind and loving things to him right off the bat. Like I used to be like, come on, get up. It's time to go. And instead I was saying, hey, how you doing this morning? And, you know, rubbing his feet and wishing him good morning and telling him all the things that I really appreciate about him and, you know, how kind he is and just how awesome he is. Who doesn't want to wake up to that?
Yeah, really? Oh, man. Mom of the Year award.
Yeah, right. Not every day, but some days. It's some days I will take that, but not every day. Let me tell you, there's a lot of struggles, you know, and we've got, you know, a lot of challenges that we've come up against and parenting. My gosh, it's an up and down thing, you know, just like anything else. But I find that if, you know, even when I struggle or even when I'm working through some of these challenges, that I'm so grateful that I have a root in this teachings and that I know where I want to end up. And so even if I dabble in chaos, which all of us do, right? It's like, I know, oh, peace is the way, the goal, the means, thought, word, and action. Well, sometimes I get up and go, ah, I don't like this. Or I don't want this to happen. And I want to fight all day long.
Yeah.
But yeah. Oh, yeah.
All you it's can like, control is you, like, though, right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly right. And so if I invest some of my energy in chaos, then I'm going to get more chaos. And if I invest some of my energy in peace, it's just like, what I'm grateful for is I have a really short karmic wheel. Like the other day I went out to my car and I opened up the car door and it hit me in the shin. And I was like, God, dang, you know, and then I slammed my car and it hit the seatbelt and bounced back and hit me again. And I was like, oh, okay. All right. I was like, all right, I got this. Breathe, because, you know, it's coming back to me. And luckily my wheel is fast and I can see it quickly. It's not years down the road that I'm dealing with this karma. It's quick. So I'm like, okay, how much more time do I want to spend in that wheel?
Yeah. Tell us more about the karmic wheel. I haven't heard about that. And it sounds interesting.
Well, I really like karma because it's kind of like the cheat sheet of like what's coming back to you. It's kind of like future telling. But it's this concept that what I put out is what's returning to me. And it can be like law of attraction in some ways, although law of attraction doesn't really allow for some past life type issues or things that come up like, why is this happening to me? And that's where a lot of people get tripped up like, well, hey, I had all this stuff that I didn't expect to come back to me, but we're not aware of all of the actions that have been taking place for whatever, how many, whether you believe in it or not, lifetimes or even this lifetime, we're not aware of every single action we took or the reaction that would come from that. So it's this basic concept that every action has a reaction. And like my action out the car, slamming the car, I had a literal reaction to that. I put out this harsh energy. It came right back to me. Mm-hmm. And it might not come back right away. It might be that I put it out. It might be like I said something about someone and it didn't come back to me. Well, now it came back to me through some other way.
Right.
And it's about saying that, okay, well, I can't control the past karma that I put out, but I can start fresh right now and put forth everything I can. So whatever comes up, even if it's like past old stuff, greet it with peace. And whatever other people's karma, you know, you come into contact with other people, I can't control what they do, but I can control my actions. And that would be with peace. And even if it's got to be a strong conversation or it's got to be a strong boundary I've got to put up, I can do that peacefully and with a lot of kindness.
Yeah. Well, what does that look like? A strong boundary that's done with peaceful kindness? Because we talk a lot about boundaries. Let's say your teenager, John, is doing something you don't love and you need the boundary there. How do you handle that?
That is a really good one. With the boundaries, you always start with what is the most sacred, because when you put up a boundary, it's a fence, right? And that is something that is protecting the most sacred thing to you. So I always start with what is the thing that I'm really trying to protect here?
Ah.
And I go deeper into it and try to understand it first, because there's no sense putting up a fence that I don't even know what I'm protecting, because what do I care if somebody runs over something I didn't even know what it was there for anyway?
Yeah, yeah.
So an example that I use often is one that was really difficult that I did do with my family. There was this kind of culture amongst some of my family where, and it wasn't even my immediate family, but it was part of my family that would kind of talk behind each other's back. You ever know anybody like that? You know,
of course.
And they would kind of talk negatively. And what I realized, I got off the phone one day with someone who was talking negatively about another family member. And I thought, I don't feel so good about that conversation. I really don't feel good. And so I used my techniques. It's like, well, what was I just thinking about? What was going on there? And I was like, well, you know, it doesn't work for me when I talk negatively about my family. I love my family, and that's not unconditional love for me. And then I come back to when I'm building a boundary, I ask, what can I do to make sure they don't do it again? Because I'm not responsible for them. I'm responsible for me. And so I ask, what will I do? And what are my boundaries? So I take full responsibility and say, for me, that doesn't work. For me, it's not okay to talk negative around other people. And so what will I do? Here comes the fence. What will I do? And what I decided what I'll do is I will say something. Like either I'll say, I don't want to talk about that, or I'll change the subject, or I'll say, it's time for me to go now. And I'll give myself an exit plan, because that's not something I want to partake in.
Yeah.
So what I decided to do then was communicate this, which was a really interesting process also. It's not necessary to communicate this in the way that I did, and it was risky. But being who I am and doing what I do, I felt like it was a great opportunity for me to share my lessons and not belittle anyone, but totally take responsibility for what I was going to do going forward. So I sent out an email that said, hey, you know, what's something that's really important to me is our family. And I started with what my goal was for me. And I spoke in me terms, not anybody else. And I said, you know, something that really bothers me is if other people talk about negatively about my family. And so for me, what I intend to do is not do that. And so if that happens when I'm around or within a conversation with me, please know I'll change the subject, or I'm going to ask to stop it, or I'm going to leave the conversation, because it's really important for me that I show unconditional love to our family. There's enough people out there that aren't into that, that I can, you know, not have to deal with. But for my family, that's something that's really important to me. And I want to be a leader in my family in that way.
Yeah.
And right away, I got a lot of calls like, oh, are you mad at me? What happened there? What? And everybody, because we come from a Catholic family. We have a long line of guilty consciences. Uh-huh. And I said, no, it's not that. But I do want you guys to know that this is really important to me. And I love you guys. And that goes for all of you, even the ones that we're talking about like that. It doesn't matter to me who it is, but this is what I will do. And so that's how boundaries work for me, is about what I'm going to do and what my actions are, not that I'm going to stop everybody from doing that. That's their karma. For me, it's about what I do with what happens to me.
Yeah, you can only control yourself. Well, your themes all come back together. It's so beautiful. Have you written a book, Anne, or are you going to write a book? Because I hope you will.
Oh, you're so sweet. You're so sweet. I actually have written many books, and they are all in shambles, because I try to always put down every single thing I've ever learned in the world into one book, and then it becomes really boring. But I have been working with a friend of mine, and I'm working on a book that's a little bit more diagram based and more like bits of wisdom based than, and so it's becoming a lot more authentic. I think I thought I was going to start and write all this stuff down. It was going to be awesome. But I really want it to be something that you can flip open a page to, that you can feel like, oh yeah, that's what I needed right now. Okay.
Yeah. I love that style of book. Well, speaking of books, what are your favorite books?
Well, there's so many. And I love, you know, that it should be something that, you know, other people want to pick up. And one thing that I like to use, it's not exactly a book. I think of it as an unbound book, but I like the Archangel Oracle cards by Doreen Virtue. And the reason I like these cards and is because a lot of us, it's hard to hear our inner voice because we're so, you know, trained to make sure that everybody else is okay and listen to other people or what we should do. And my training is to listen to yourself and to go inward for that wisdom. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's hard to hear that. And I feel like these cards are a really cool way to learn really positive, really kind, really loving messages, unconditionally loving messages about your current situation. And you can just, I don't know if you've ever opened up a book just to a page and like, yes, that's what I needed right now. But this is kind of like that, because you can pull a few cards and then read about what the cards mean. And some of the cards that I really love are like relationship harmony, or you can pull a card, take back your power. And it just gives really helpful insight on that it's all okay and this is a normal part of life. And they're very, very supportive and kind and loving. And their messages, if you believe in angels, their messages from your higher self in that form. And so I really love that. And I have had a lot of people get a lot from having these cards to go to when they're really struggling. Just pull three cards and listen to what, you know, your higher self is helping you with.
Oh, love that. Well, I want to tell our listeners, we'll have links to everything you talked about, those oracle cards and your website. And also you have a guided meditation gift for us, right? Tell us a little about that.
Yes, I do. You know, I talked about like my morning routine is getting up. And actually one of my friends, she took this meditation and or one of my meditations and she made it her ringtone on her phone. So what she does is she set her alarm in the morning. And instead of like a rah, 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 it's actually me that comes on there and says, good morning, it's time to meditate. And so you can buy yourself an extra 10 or 11 minutes in bed and just really get aligned. And you don't have to do a darn thing. You can just sit back and listen.
Oh, that's
and
smart.
Get into that space. Yeah. So that's my good friend, Amy. And so I wanted to give something. My teachings, I feel like I want you to be able to turn around and teach them now, like in this minute and neck tomorrow, any of this stuff. And so I hope that, you know, this is one of those things that you can take around and turn it around really quickly and, you know, use it tomorrow morning if you want to and give yourself that chance to take back your morning, restart, refresh, and you know, align with that peace for yourself.
Awesome. Yeah, we'll have that meditation on our show notes page at jenriday.com/110. Thanks so much for sharing that, Anne. I can't wait to do that. And gosh, to have it as a ringtone and just do it while I'm still in bed? Yeah, I can do that.
Well, Jen, I just want to say that, you know, getting ready for this show and just listening to the podcast, I've got to tell you that what you're doing is really special and really absolutely needed. And I was just listening to some of these stories and I was thinking with every person, you know, sometimes they have another job. I'm like, oh my gosh, they have another job. They could be doing this full time. I mean, this is just, I need to hear this wisdom. And
yeah.
I feel like years ago, we all would have sat around and listened to each other and helped each other and used our whole life experiences to do that. And you're just creating a space where we can do that. And so what you're doing is very special and important. And I just want to thank you for this.
Oh, well, thank you. I mean, I love hearing stories from everyone and yours was no exception. But before we go, I do want to ask, what does it mean for you to be a vibrant and happy woman if you had to narrow it down?
For me, it's being here in this present moment, being love, like really choosing to be that environment of love and letting go of all the rest of it.
Wow.
That's the job. That's the life.
Be love and let go of the rest. And how about a challenge from you to our listeners and then remind us again where we can find you and we'll say goodbye.
Okay, awesome. Well, my challenge is that to download the meditation because it's something I really did create in thinking about how can I help you? How can I give you something that will make it so easy that you don't have to do more in your life, that you can just enjoy your life more? So if you can get up and try this meditation or any meditation, there's Insight Timer as an app and give yourself that time in the morning to just align and shine. I feel like it will really help you to take your day back and feel good about life and just enjoy this, what you have.
Oh, that's so great. And again, that awesome meditation is on the show notes page at jenriday.com/110. And I'm so glad I got to interview someone that lives so close to me. Everyone, you can be jealous because I know Anne in person.
Same here. I know you.
Thank you so much for being on the show, Anne. This was fantastic.
Thank you, Jen.
Thank you so much for listening. And I hope it gave you some uplift and some inspiration. For those of you who would like to get your hands on that guided meditation that Anne talked about, you can get it on our show notes page at jenriday.com/110, jenriday.com/110. This is episode 110. My goodness, the time flies, and I love every minute of it. I feel so privileged to get to sit across the microphone from these amazing, amazing women and to get to hear about their lives, but then also to get to share it with you. And I hope that we're all shifting upward together, rising up, stepping forward into our strength and our ability and our intuition and using our gifts to make the world better. I want to challenge each of you listening to be a light. Be a light. Find the light for yourself and then be a light to others because we make the world a happier place in the process. I am so grateful you listened. Thank you for being here. I will see you next time. And until then, take care.
Thanks for listening to the Vibrant Happy Women Podcast at www.jenriday.com.